Hello, I'm gonna talk about functional way of the web, and you'll see it unroll. My name is Erki. I'm a founder and a lead designer and UI developer at Digit. I also do a bit of software consulting, and previously I spent 9 years at Skype in different roles, from web backend to frontend, and finally a couple of years in design prototyping team, where I built lots of future Skype product prototypes. But coming back to Digit, and now we are a company that is building new types of visual communication tools, and they're meant for teams to solve team communication problems, problems that teams face right now and that they will face in the future when they grow. And we start building our first application, which is a real-time collaborative whiteboard. And you can think of it as an infinite canvas for all kinds of visual content. And our document structure is based on a hypergraph structure, which is just a tree that can contain data and visual elements and relationships between them. And we built it as a as your typical JavaScript single page model view controller application. But soon we ran into issues scaling the application, well, adding functionality and then new types of data models and stuff like that. The internal complexity grew a lot, and that caused us a lot of problems with bugs that were hard to find and hard to debug, rendering performance issues, especially on mobile devices, because our application is cross-device based on web technologies. And mobile is constrained in that sense. And also because our data model really didn't fit into your typical JavaScript framework data collections, and we had issues there where we needed to solve. So I went looking for a solution to these problems that we were facing. And I tried lots of different kind of frameworks, big and small, libraries, small bits, and finally I found Facebook's React library. And it's meant for creating UIs. And React manages the DOM for you, and it responds to user events. And you can think of it as the view in the model view controller. So it's kind of like a view and the view controller bound together. But it didn't really click for me, would React fit for our purpose or not, until I found David Nolan's OM framework. And the OM framework is a closure script interface to React. And what's interesting there is David made use of closure's immutable data structures to make React blazingly fast. So it was the first framework that actually realized the best parts of the React way of rendering things. And I thought instead of just telling what it is, let's see a quick example. Your typical to-do list application that you can find these for any web framework you want, right? And here there's two benchmarks. One is it just creates 200 to-do items and renders them. And this is the OM version. So you can see it rendered in about 140 milliseconds, right? And the second benchmark is again, it creates 200 to-do items. Let's reset. Checks and unchecks them 5 times. So if you have a to-do item, right, you can check it. Now it's done, right. And this one does 200 of them and clicks them 5 times, or basically changes the data that it checked, unchecked 5 times. And yeah, what? 5 milliseconds. Really? All right. And then later it clears the list as well. And here's the backbone version. Okay, the first one, 200 items. How much is that? Okay, 400 milliseconds. Not bad. The other one was, 30 something. But this one also creates 200 of them, checks them 5 times, unchecks them 5 times, then removes them. Wait, what's going on? Wow, 7 seconds of unresponsive UI. So what's going on in here? Let's see. I made quick, did I lose them? All right, let's do a quick profiling of this. Let's run this and then run that. Stop. You can see that in OM, it's quite simple, right? It handles the click, and this is the rendering part. There's not a lot of things going on here. There's basically the rendering is happening only once, and when 200 of them are created and checked unchecked, the rendering is still really, really fast. But in the backbone version, this one, that one. And mind you that it's right now blocking all user input as it does this. So you can see that there's lots and lots and lots of stuff going on. Let's take a closer look. So you can see there's triggering events and triggering events and updating the DOM, triggering events, updating the DOM, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that makes it slow. So in rendering UIs, it should be a simple thing. You have data, you have some component, you render it, and the DOM, you know, shows it in the browser, right? And in simple MVC applications, it is simple usually. There's a model, a couple of models, like view, updates DOM, you get events back, you update that. But if it gets more, there's more models, more views, more linking between them. So if you update something, it causes my model to update that maybe event gets triggered to another view that updates, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And because views are managing the DOM directly, and the DOM is slow, there's a lot of overhead that we could do without. And what React does is closer to the original. You know, you get data, you pass it into a component, and it gets rendered in DOM. And React takes care of a lot of that DOM management for you, so you don't have to think about it that much. And it does a lot of optimized rendering of the DOM. So it renders all the components and renders the DOM only once. And that happens like this, so you understand what's going on in there. You have data one, right? You pass it into a component, it passes back a virtual DOM. And that's just a set of JavaScript objects describing what the output is. It's not a string of HTML that you usually get in these kind of template frameworks. It's a virtual DOM. So user does something, causes data to change the data to, right? That gets passed again to the same UI component, you get back a virtual DOM too. And there's React implements this kind of DOM diffing algorithm. It compares the two DOMs, gets a diff. It creates DOM operations based on that diff. And then it applies all those DOM operations together. So that's what's going on. And that's why the one was so much faster than the other, because the data was still changed like 200 times, or actually 1,000 times behind the scenes. But the rendering only happened once, because there weren't any events involved, any unneeded DOM updating involved, etc. So how did OM actually do that? There's a bunch of lifecycle methods in React, but the most important one is the shoot component update. And what OM does, it can implement that really quickly. So this one is before the item is rendered. React asks, should this component even render, or should we reuse the old virtual DOM? And OM does this immutable data comparison really quickly, because data that was passed in before, and if it hasn't changed, the comparison is really quick. So you can actually, optimize a lot of, if the data didn't change, the view doesn't need to change, right? So OM did that. And after David Nolan put out these demos, there's one that updates 10,000 DOM elements every request animation frame cycle, so 60 times a second, that it's flying on mobile devices and on desktop as well. He tweeted this, that 30 or 40 times faster than usual. You can read it. It's nothing to do with ClojureScript per se or the OM framework. Just don't use stateful objects, teach events, be declarative, use immutability, and that's it. You can make your applications really that much faster. And so, because our code base was all written in JavaScript, and there's about, I don't know, 40,000 lines of code. It wasn't very feasible to actually move that everything over to ClojureScript and start using this. So I started, you know, investigating how can we use these concepts in regular JavaScript. So I found out that the same guy who created the OM actually has extracted the ClojureScript immutable data structures out into a library called Mori. So you get the same kind of very powerful data structures like vectors, lists, hash maps, all kinds of functions to iterate and over them and manage those structures, and a lot of helper functions from functional programming paradigms, you know, maps, reduce, transduce, etc. So you can manage the data using functional tricks. And there was a particular functional burl in there that isn't documented, but it is part of the library. And that is called the Huet zippers. And there's a paper from 2002, maybe. No, I don't know exactly, but Clojure has implemented this. And the zippers are just, you know, functional hierarchical, you know, if you have a tree structure, the zipper is kind of like a pointer to the tree structure. And if you have the zipper object, it knows its location in the tree, and it knows how to navigate to other parts of the tree. But it's all very, the zipper object is really small. It just has pointers to the tree. And if you move down the tree, you get a new zipper, and that knows where it is located in the tree and can navigate around. So I found this, that this is part of the Mori package as well. And that was what actually made me, you know, or convinced me that this approach should fit our original problem, right? That we can use it, or the question was, can we use the immutable data structures with our graph data structure? Can we make use of zippers to, you know, navigate around this structure? Can we make it rendering efficient? So so I derived the example from the kind of stuff that we do. This is like a mind map. Ours is a, you know, whiteboard that can contain any kind of visual data, also mind maps, because here you have nodes, relationship between nodes. And because our data is in JSON format, because that's easy to, you know, store on the server. It's REST API friendly, so I can update only one piece of this. So it looks kind of like this. So that maps should map to that, right? So the hello one is the root node. And here I say that the root node is special with the dollar mark, and it has no parent, so that makes it the root node, right? So one has a parent of the dollar, so that lorem is underneath hello. Ipsum is also underneath hello, et cetera, et cetera. You can see that this parent is 5, et cetera. And it's collapsed as well, so one is collapsed there. So this kind of data structure is what's behind the scenes. It's not a tree structure, it's a flat JSON, right? Simple to store, simple to fetch, simple to update. So let's see some code, how we actually apply these kind of Mori data structures and zippers, and how we can render this kind of stuff. Let's see. Here it explains. Is that readable? Kind of. So again, this is the JSON. So what I do with this initially is I pass it to this function. This is a mind map object, and initial it with the JSON data. I create a mapping. It's a hash map just, and I create the first one. So the parent is null, and I create an empty set there. And I parse this JSON data into Mori's or this kind of Clojure's hash map using that function. So the data is now a hash map in the Mori data structure, right? So I go over of this data, I extract the key and the value, the pairs in the JSON, and I do some magic here, but the main trick is I create this mapping, right? So I update the mapping, I take the parent, and put it into the mapping structure. So it goes over all the input, and because the root node could have been at the end, right? It doesn't matter where it is. I have to go over this and create the mapping of parents and children here. And finally, I basically save this data, and I'll show it what it looks like. So the JSON gets turned into the a hash map like this. This is the closures way of showing it as a string. So key one has a text lorem parent, da, 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 et cetera, et cetera. Almost the same as the JSON one. And the mapping is that the nil is the root node, right? The root node has no parent. The node number 3 has 2 children, right? Node number 5 has 1 children. The root node has 3 children. So those are the kind of things that I keep in memory, right? And going back to the how can I go over this these two hash maps now in a very easy way, so I can actually traverse it as a tree. So here there's a function from a tree from ID. So I pass in ID. By default, it's the dollar. I want the root node, right? And I create a zipper. And this is the Mori library provides this zipper. So in closure, the zippers are available for XML and some other data structures for you, like XML zipper, and pass it in XML. You can traverse XML using the zipper API. But here, I create a custom zipper. I pass in three functions. One is for checking is this a branch or a leaf. One is for getting child nodes for this node where I'm at. And one is for making nodes, making new nodes. I don't make use of this here. And these are actually quite simple. If I go look at these, each branch node is just checks in the tree map. It gets the node's ID and checks in the tree map and counts are there any children underneath. And if there are, it returns true. If not, it returns false. So only branches that are, only nodes that have children are branches, are considered branches, right? And this one just returns me the child nodes for this. It will get the node ID, get it from the tree map, go over all the elements that it got from there and gets them from the tree data. So it returns those child nodes, are basically those, like for example, for number 5, right? Because 5 has a child number 6, it returns an array of or list of elements which contains this, right? So it just returns the data back to me. So that's about it. So to create a new zipper object, I only have to pass in a couple of simple functions. And now that I have this tree, so this one returns me the zipper object. So it's just an object that knows I'm in this place in the tree at the root node. If I ask him to go down, it will go down to the first child. I get the new zipper. If I ask that to go left, it goes to the left child. If I ask that to go right, it goes to the right child, etc. So it can navigate the tree. I can navigate it left first or width first or however I want. If I'm deep in the tree, I can go back up, etc. So here I'm just a sample of how to. So this one gets the root tree, right? Internally, it just does that, get the tree from ID and the dollar sign, and calls the recursive log tree function. And the log tree just gets the node for me, because the log is, this is the zipper, like location in the tree, right? And I can use the zipper node and pass in the pointer to that zipper, and I get back the node that actually in that place in the tree. I ask like to have a child node. I try to step down. If there's no child node beneath it, it will return null, right? And if there were child nodes, I just for loop over it and then call this log tree recursively again. And here I just use the process console group end, etc. to step into the function. Now let's see it quickly. So let's see. So here, just the result is then, you know, it just shows you that, that the root is the hello. Inside there, there's a lorem. It has that kind of data. Inside there's a dollar, right? That has child nodes, et cetera. So I can actually traverse this tree in a quite simple way, right? Not a lot of code. Basically, just go down, go right, go down, go right, go down, go right. So that's how I can navigate the tree. And let's see how I can now create this kind of rendering output of that. For that, we'll see. We'll start at the mind map node. So maybe also inspect this a bit. So what we have here is we have the mind map div, SVG inside that. There's a top level group. And inside there's a edges node and children, right? So this is the root node. Inside there's a rect, that's just a box around it and the text. So and this is the root node. So we start from there. So in rect, like I showed before, there's a couple of you know, lifecycle events or lifecycle methods, like shoot component updates, and one of them is render. You have to implement render, and you have to return virtual DOM or null out of it. And here, this is just React supports this JSX where you can type almost like HTML inside JavaScript here. It's just a syntactic sugar. Behind the scenes, it just calls a function to create those divs. So I create the div, I create SVG, and here I trigger the render mind map. And the render mind map just gets the mind map tree, the tree at the root node, gets the root node out of that, and calls this create element and renders it as a mind map element. And passes in the zipper, that it, the location in the tree that it's right now, passes in the node, passes in meta, I'll come to that later, and just that the root node is centered in the middle and positioned in the middle, right? So this is, you know, this is the mind map view component, right? And this renders the root node. And if I look at that, again, the render function here of the mind map node. So this is a component for rendering all these rectangular things with text and edges on them. And I basically just, you know, output this group with the node data as a rect and text, and I'll get the text from the node data itself. But because I passed in the zipper as well, or the location in the tree, I can actually ask for the try to again step down, right? Z down tries to go down in the tree, and if there's a child node there, it returns something. So if there was a child node, I loop over all the immediate children. I go right. So I step down once and go over all the nodes in there, collect them in an array, and pass in their chip zippers. So for each of them, I pass in a new kind of tree pointer, that child node, metadata for that, and I anchor it to the left. And I say that your key is whatever the ID. And here I just map over all these children. So this, because it's an array of those objects, right? Zippers and nodes. I map over them. This is edges, wait. This is the children. I render the child nodes. And child node does the same thing, basically. It creates an element, which is the same kind of mind map element. And the props is just the zippers and nodes, and et cetera. So this one, if it has children, it recursively renders a new mind map element. And if that one has children, it recursively internally renders those, et cetera, until it reaches all the leaves which don't have children, and then it comes back out, right? So that if I load the data like that, so you can see this happening here. And if I look at the markup, so this is the root node. It has children. Each one of them is a group, right? This one is that node, right? It has no children. This one also has no children. The last one has children. So these are the same thing again, et cetera, et cetera. And Rack provides also a nice developer tool to see those, not just as a DOM structure, but as actual rect elements, right? So this is the mind map element that rendered the G. Inside that we have children. These are all mind map elements. I can check the values here if I want. If I step into these, I can see that this one rendered this. And it has children again, two children, it rendered those. This one doesn't have children anymore, etc. So you can see how we use the same component to render each node. But because we could traverse this tree easily, we just, you know, the code involved is quite shockingly short. Basically just, you know, collect all the children, render your bit, and render all the children again. So let's see what next. So that's awesome, right? If the data doesn't change, it doesn't really matter. You know, render it once, render it twice. But let's say that the other problem I had was because I can have like thousands of these, because we are a collaborative whiteboard application. If you zoom out, there's, you know, loads and loads of stuff. And because it's real time and collaborative, that means that data changes all the time. Other people on their devices can change stuff. It changes here, you can change stuff, it changes here. So the potentially it can, you know, a large amount of data can change at any time. So the rendering must be efficient as well. So I'll show you how Mori helped with that as well. Let's see, I'll enable a little debug line here. So let's see, every time a node renders, I'll log it here. So at the data load, every node renders, right? If I clear that and toggle this, we can see that only two nodes actually render. Rest of them know that they didn't change. We always, every time the mind map data structure changes, we start rendering from the root again. From the root, we go down, 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 down. So now we're trying to make it efficient. So if this branch up here didn't change, I don't need to go and visit that at all. I'll just, you know, leave it that as it is using the old virtual DOM. But if I click here, right, I want only these nodes to render. So if I close this, what should happen is these get removed because they're not relevant anymore. This one gets updated, and also because the rendering starts from the root node, I have to actually update that one as well to be able to step down the tree. So you can see that the number three, this is one number three, and the root node actually updated. The rest of them didn't render. For this one, what happened behind the scene was we asked it, should you update? It says yes, because it changed. For this one, we should ask, should you update? And it efficiently says, no, I don't need to change. This one says, should you update? No, I don't need to change. This one, should you change? Yes, I need to change, because that one was what we changed. So I'll show you how I managed to do that. So, so let's see the mind map. So when I click the when I click on it, what happens is this function, this gets stored, mind map toggle node. I get the mind map ID and the node ID that I should change, right? Mind map scratch and node ID 3, for example. And this one just gets the mind map object for me, and from there I'll get the specific node. And here I just say collapse this is not collapse, basically. Whatever, I just toggle it, true, false, true, false. And I say mind map set node, this node ID, and that new data. And here you can see the immutable data, because I'm updating this old node data, but every time you update that object actually doesn't change. That's the point of the persistent immutable data, that the old one, if somebody has a reference to that, that didn't change. You'll get back a new object. This this is a new object that has just this collapse change. But internally, the data structure actually shares. Everything else that didn't change is actually shared. If you look into the closure data structures, you'll see that internally it's a very efficient linked list implementation. So if this, you know, hash map of that node is there's lots of data in it, and I just change one of them, I get back a new reference to a new object. But internally, that shares lots of that data with the old version. Until the old version is forgotten, garbage collected, then only that bit that was different for that old version is garbage collected as well. So here I update it and then call the mind map node, set node. And here's a little trickery that to make it, actually I'll cover say this first. Let's look at the shoot component update. So this is the decision that shoot this component even, you know, render or not. And it's simple. I just checked. Is the node is just a hash map of that data, right? The label and the position, etc. I check if the current one that we know about is different from the next one, or if the meta info is different from the next one. And if it is, we render. If they're the same, we don't render. And that's the only, you know, global basically optimization for rendering. That's the only thing I needed to add to not make these other branches update. So if I disable this and toggle this, same thing, you can see that all the nodes in this tree change all the time because there's no optimization, right? So I add it back, and now let's clear this. Now only again these couple of them change that are actually in there. So that's the trick. So there's the data comparison itself. If I change the text, it will pick that up and render it again. If I change the meta info, it will pick up that as well. So the trick here was that because Mori and Closure, if you have a hash map or any of their functions or any of the data structures, they can have meta information attached to them. So we have hash map that has values. And you can ask, does this object have a meta info as well? So what's it useful is for example, if you get a bunch of data and you want to know if it came from a cache or if it came from a, you know, live API query or whatever, if that's important for you. So one way is to put that information into the hash map itself, for example. But that way you just, you know, add more data that's not relevant to the actual data you're trying to solve. So Closure and Mori allow you to add meta information to every object. So every object in this hash map has a meta info attached, and I'll show it here as well. This is here with meta. When I initially parse the JSON data, there's a meta information that's also a hash map, and it has revision zero. So at first, all the nodes have revision zero on them, and when I set the nodes or like update them, I actually go over and update all the meta revisions. So I go get the current revision and increase it, right? So and return the meta object back and then update it. So what happens is if I click this one here, the number 3 node, I go there, I update its revision, so it's one larger than before, and then I go up to the parent and update that revision, so it's one bigger than before. So if I toggle, for example, this one gets revision 2, this one gets revision whatever, plus 1, right? Revision plus 1, revision plus 1. And now when I, now the rendering comes in, looks at this, the information is the same. The label is the same, etc. Node equals node, right? But the meta information is different than before. Okay, so I need to re-render this one. The node data is the same as before, but the meta information is different. So I render this one, goes up there. Those are meta and node data are the same. So that doesn't need to render. This one changed. Okay, this needs to render, and because those were hidden before, those get rendered as well. So that's the trick that this this data structure, the Mori data structure, help us achieve. But if you think about internally, still there's the tree data. That's a hash map, and the tree mapping. That just, you know, the sets that which node has which, you know, child nodes. So internally, it's very easy to, you know, go in and debug that data, dump it out and see what it's like. Get the specific, you know, I can say that this one is just make this as the focus node. So I start rendering from this one, so the parent nodes don't get rendered. Stuff that's useful in a mind map application, for example, for in our case in our visualization. So you can show some bits, some other bits get hidden, etc. And the whole, you know, rendering is very, very efficient. And that's about it. Just if you're interested, there's lots of information about React. You go to React website, there's stuff there. But I found these really, really useful. The first one is the David Nolan's blog. There's samples of the closure script and OM in there. The second one is also goes over why closure script and React are really a nice match. So if you're a Java developer or you know closure, take a look at closure script. So basically that's closure code compiled into JavaScript. Maybe it's useful for you. This one is just also very, very useful sample that just goes deep into the React, like what makes it different, covers what the React internals, how they were influenced by the functional design patterns, etc. So we pass in data, and if it's the same thing, you get the same thing out, right? And this one just covers React's diff algorithm very well. It just shows you how it's able to, after you render it and you have the virtual DOM, how it's able to diff the previous version, the new one, and create those DOM operations that are only needed, right? Not the rest of them. And so any questions regarding this? Yes? Well, React is supports up from IE8 upwards, I think. So if you use that, there's no really problems that I found that are browser compatibility problems. They test on mobile devices, etc. Facebook web page actually uses React to render it, so they have worked a lot, hard on making it optimized and work cross browsers. Of course, we for our applications, this is just the view part, right? The more it provides us with the data structures and nice functional ways of managing that data, changing and walking over the tree, etc., and then diffing it, so I can quickly compare stuff without having to do deep equal checks, etc. But we use also Facebook created a or described the pattern that they used called Flux. Facebook Flux. We use a reflux JS library to manage the other parts of the problem. The model view controller gives you certain tools, and you only have view with the React, so you still need some other tools to create those. So we used reflux JS to do the other parts to achieve this kind of data flow that they say is good. So if UI interaction happens, you create an action, that action changes the data, and that trickles down to your view that renders. So it's like unidirectional. There's always user actions always change the data directly, and that trickles down to your application and causes renders. So we solved with that, and like I said before, that we started with about 40,000 lines of code application, typical MVC application, and after moving our data structures over to Mori or views over to React, and using the reflux kind of data flow approach to building the application, we decreased the code size by 38%. So less code, easier to find things, easier to reason about, easier to debug rendering issues, easier to make optimize the rendering, for example. So yeah, that's what we learned from functional programming. Zippers, the immutable data, don't use events, don't use stateful objects, and you can make your applications, JavaScript applications, really, really fast. Thank you. We're over time, so have a good lunch.